I'm interested in this argument. I'd just like to pick it up right there that uniformity is important and therefore nationwide injunctions assure uniformity. I was under the impression that's why we had a United States Supreme Court. I thought that in the structure of Article III, we had one United States Supreme Court, and indeed, if I recall correctly, that court has been at pains to emphasize many times that there is one Supreme Court, not a thousand, one, and that we have that in order to assure uniformity across the lower courts. I don't understand why, if district courts can each issue nationwide injunctions, over a thousand of them, why we need the United States Supreme Court. I mean, maybe we don't need it anymore. Professor Bray, let me just ask you to address this, because I know that you've written about this. What's your view about what the United States Supreme Court has said about the practice of issuing injunctions, about how that works with, interfaces with, as an expression of the case and controversy requirement and also the judicial power under Article III?
So I think this is right. I think uniformity is a value. There's a good thing to have uniformity, and that's a reason we have the U.S. Supreme Court, and that is also why it is so important that we have appeals from state Supreme Court decisions about the U.S. Constitution to the Supreme Court to ensure that there is a uniform, ultimate interpretation of the Constitution. But uniformity is also a value that makes it impossible to draw the lines between different kinds of cases and come up with a middle ground. Because as Ms. Ali Khan said, uniformity is good in immigration, uniformity is good in environmental law, uniformity is good in food and safety, Uniformity was good in the arguments against the Obama administration and the Trump administration. It can always be put on the scales. So the question is not, is uniformity good? The question is, how do we get to uniformity? And the Supreme Court is the way we get to uniformity in the judiciary. And so it's just a short-circuiting of that process to try to get to uniformity. So I recognize this means bad things can happen in the meantime. That is just like part of the deal of having lots of courts, multiple circuits, circuit splits before it gets to the Supreme Court. But you got to take the bitter with the sweet. And the idea, the hope, is that we'll get better decision making when we ultimately get uniformity in the Supreme Court.
Professor Bray, are you familiar with the argument that in creating administrative agencies and in delegating some authority to them, Congress also gave to courts, to Article III courts, the right and power to issue nationwide injunctions?
I am familiar with the argument. I disagree with the argument.
Why don't you tell us why?
So one reason is there was no pattern of national injunctions before the APA. Another is that when the APA refers to set aside, that actually is not the language you would use for an injunction. That is the language you would use for vacating a judgment by an agency. And that's not an accident. That's because at the time of the APA, the agencies didn't make a lot of rules. That's not what Congress was even thinking the agencies would be doing. Congress was thinking on the model of things like the ICC, the agencies would be making adjudications, and then those adjudications, which are for the parties, could be set aside by the courts. So it all fits. The background, the text, the legislative history fits with the idea that courts are deciding the case for the parties, even under the APA.
Let me ask you to say something more about Gill versus Whitford, which you mentioned, I think, in your opening statement. As I recall that decision, the Supreme Court expressly held a district court can issue an injunction only if the injunction is, and I'm quoting the court now, tailored to redress the plaintiff's particular injury. Is that your memory?
That's correct.
Why don't you explain the significance of that?
So what the court does in that opinion, and it's an opinion for a unanimous court, is connect the rule that remedies are supposed to protect the plaintiffs to the constitutional role of the courts under Article III. So that equivalence is not one that I'm making as an academic matter. Like, that is one that the Supreme Court itself just 2 years ago said. Now, so I think that's its grounding. It's grounded in constitutional structure.
The court also said in that case that the court's constitutionally prescribed role is to vindicate the individual rights of the people appearing before it. Can you explain to us again, what's the significance of that, and why is the judicial power tailored and limited in this way?
So this goes to the very essence of a court as opposed to a legislature. You enact legislation that is general, and you're not allowed to do a bill of attainder, for example. You can't go decide one person's case. But for courts, it's the other way around. The judiciary has the strength that its judgments must be followed, but its judgments are judgments as to the parties. It is its strength and its weakness, and it is of the essence of the judicial role that judges decide cases.